All right, let's get started. Welcome, everybody. So it's a pleasure to welcome our speaker today. It's Sasha Ushakov from the Stevens Institute of Technology, and he's going to tell us something about quadratic equations in bumps like solid arc groups.
Okay, thank you. This is a joint work with Richard Mandel. Yes, and so the main results of our work are we show that the Diophantine problem for quadratic equations in bounds like solid arc groups, you know, they can be parameterized with two integers m and n. So in general, quadratic equations, okay. So the Diophantine problem is the problem to decide if a given equation has a solution or not. Yes, and here we prove that the Diophantine problem for quadratic equations is NP-hard basically whenever the group is in some sense is non-trivial. Okay, so I'm going to discuss these conditions. Yes, and that gives basically a lower bound on the complexity of the Diophantine problem for those groups. So we have NP-hardness. And also we find an upper bound on the complexity. So we show that the Diophantine problem belongs to NP whenever basically our group is metabelian or whenever it's unimodular. So whenever one of the parameters is plus or minus one, or the absolute value of M is the same as the absolute value of N. Okay, also we investigate parametric complexity of this problem. So, you know what? Let me actually jump a few slides down. So, let me go to the definition of standard quadratic equations. So, a standard quadratic equation is an equation of this form. And you see, in this equation, we have basically two parameters. We have genus G, and we have this value M, which I believe on the previous slide is called K. Okay, so our next result basically claims that if you bound this value M, so if you consider only the equation, only the equations in which the value of M is bounded, in that case, you get polynomial time complexity for the Diophantine problem. Okay, so let me go up. Okay, so indeed, the Diophantine problem for quadratic equations in BSMN can be solved in this time. Okay, so what is that? N is the size of the description of a given equation. K, well, that number K is actually M on the next slide. So the K is a number of conjugates in a given equation. Okay, so the complexity, the upper bound on the complexity is N to the power big O of K. So it's a polynomial. Do you have questions? Yes, and sorry for mess here. I mean, technically I use N over here and N over here. So these are different N's. So this N is the size of the description of a given equation. Okay. Now a related previous work was done by Olga, Laura and Alexei. So they proved that systems of equations for groups BSMN, for metabelian groups BSMN, that problem is decidable.
Okay. What is the size of the description? Is it just the word, the length of the word, or?
Yes, you consider it as a word. So okay. As a sequence of letters, and you just count the letters. Okay. Yes, and then obviously our works are related. We don't consider just all the equations over BSMN. Well, technically over BS1N, we consider only quadratic equations. But still, we find a lower bound on the complexity, and we find actually in the metabelian case we find an upper bound for the complexity. of quadratic equations. We do believe that the same upper bound holds in general. So for general equations for BS1n. Yes, but that's not done yet. Yes, also perhaps I can mention that you can analyze the complexity of the Diophantine problem on average. So you can study the average case complexity, and the average case complexity is low for this problem. So for the Diophantine problem, for quadratic equations over at least over BS1n, so that problem is easy on average. Okay, so one important tool that we use in our analysis is, it's called algebraic equations with exponents. So an algebraic equation with exponents is an equation of this form, in which x1, x2, xk are variables, unknowns, q1, q2, qk, and q are rational numbers, non-trivial rational numbers, and the rational numbers, all rational numbers are given as pairs. As pairs and numbers, okay, so a pair, numerator and denominator, and numerator and denominator are given in binary. Okay, so we prove that the Diophantine problem for such equations is NP complete. Furthermore, we prove that the same holds for systems of equations with exponents. So what is a system of equations with exponents? It's a system, it's a system of equations from here, in which every equation uses the same base. So the first equation uses the base alpha 1, where alpha 1 is a rational number, which is not 0 and not 1. Yes, and same for each equation. So the last equation uses some alpha s as a base, and again alpha s is a rational number which is not trivial and which is not 1. Well, if alpha is trivial, the equation is obviously easy. If alpha is 1, again the equation is very easy. So yeah, it's natural to assume that alpha i's are not 0 and not 1. Okay, and furthermore, we can actually describe the structure for the set of all solutions of such a system. So we prove that the set of all solutions of this system is semi-linear, which in this case means that the set of all solutions capital S is a finite union of cosets. So it's a finite union of sets of the form X bar plus delta X bar. What is X bar? X bar is an element of Z to the power K. So it's an element of the free abelian group of rank K. Right? Yes, and X bar defines a particular solution. Delta X bar is a certain subgroup of Z to the power K. In some sense defined by properties of a particular solution X. Do you have questions? Okay. Okay, so let me introduce the bound slug solitaire group, BSMN. This group doesn't require much introduction, really. Yes, I believe it was discussed in this seminar. Yes, I mean, a few weeks ago. But let me do that anyway. So, by definition, a bound slug solitaire group is a one relator group, defined, parameterized by two parameters, M and N, where M and N are integers. So it's a two generated group, generators are A and T, and it's an H and an extension of the cyclic group generated by A. So yeah, you have this relation. T inverse A to the power M, T is A to the power N. I believe that these groups were studied before bound slug and solitaire, but they were named after bound slug and solitaire. After these two people proved that for some values of M and N, PSMN is non-Hopfian, which means that some of those groups are isomorphic to proper quotients of themselves, right? And the paper by Baumslag and Solliter was published in 1962. Yes, so this group was studied, for a long time. Now, algebraically, this group is not very complex, yet it's a source of very interesting combinatorial problems. So for instance, let me just mention a few recent results, relatively recent results. So recently, Murray, Folke, and June investigated the properties of geodesics in Baumslag Solliter groups. Yes, they obtained the problem, I believe, is not completely solved. In other words, geodesics are not it's not known, for instance, how to find geodesics in polynomial time in the group BS23, but still in some cases the description for geodesics were found and algorithms developed for computing geodesics. In our work with Alexei and with Andrei Nikolaev, we investigate different optimization problems. So in this paper, knapsack problems in groups, and in particular, we prove that the subset sum problem for Baumslag Solliter groups is NP complete if and only if, basically if and only if M is not the same as N. And very recently, Monsi Casals-Ruiz, Ilya Kazachkov, and Alexander Zakharov investigated the commensurability of Baumslag Solliter groups. I believe a recent speaker, Chloe Papin, yes, I hope I pronounce her name correctly, yes, also investigated some properties of Baumslag Solliter groups and developed some algorithms. So it's a very interesting object of study. Okay, so indeed, depending on N and M, so depending on the parameter values, the Baumslag Solliter group has different algebraic properties. For instance, BS11 is a free abelian group. BS1 minus 1 is the semi-direct product of Z and Z. Well, that's also known as the Klein-Battle group. BS1n is metabelian. Yes, all other groups, Baumslag Solliter groups contain F2. BSM plus minus M is virtually FM cross Z. Some of them are residually finite, some are not. Some of them are Hopfian, some are not. So I cannot really say that this class of groups is very rich, but still. Baumslag Solliter groups are different, yes, and hence we are going to use different techniques to prove results for different classes of Baumslag Solliter groups. Okay, next, let me review the equations in groups. So let's fix a group G. And let's fix a set of variables capital X. By definition, an equation with coefficients in G is a formal equality W equals to 1, where W is a formal alternating word. So it's an alternating sequence of constants from capital G, variables from capital X, and variables to the power minus 1. Okay, so for instance, your equation can look like this: as x inverse y inverse z inverse times x times y times z equals to c. So here are x, y, and z are variables, and c is a particular constant, is a particular group element of G. Technically, this constant c is on the right hand side, but obviously you can take this c to the left, right? So you can multiply that equation by c inverse on the right. Yes, and you will get the form of the you will get that form w equals to 1. Now, an assignment that satisfies W equals to one is called a solution for, yes, for the equation W is one. So any assignment for variables that occur in W, which makes the equality true, is called a solution. Okay, so very natural definition. The Diophantine problem for a class of equation C over a group G. Okay, so again, we fix a group G. A class of equation C is simply a set of equations. So the Diophantine problem for a class of equation C is an algorithmic question to decide if a given equation in C has a solution or not. Okay, and next we would like to define a quadratic equation. So again, an equation is a formal equality of this form, W is one. You say that a word W is, wait a second, and an equation W is one. So they are quadratic if every variable X occurring in W occurs exactly twice, as X or as X inverse. So for instance, X squared equals to C is a quadratic equation because X is the only variable which occurs in this equation and it occurs exactly twice as X and then again as X. The second example is also an example of a quadratic equation because here we have variables X, Y, and Z. X occurs twice as X inverse as X. Y occurs twice as Y inverse as Y. Yes, and same for Z. Okay, so that's the definition of a quadratic equation. And by the way, it's very easy to recognize that the second equation is just, it's a commutator equation. So instead of this long product, you can simply write that the commutator of XY is C. So basically, the Diophantine problem for this equation for different values of C is basically the problem to decide if C is a commutator in G or not. All right, so let me slightly explain the choice of some terminology here. So at some point I'm going to define orientable and non-orientable quadratic equations. Okay, so that that terminology comes from, it comes from types of closed compact surfaces. You see, if we have a quadratic word W in X, Y, Z, and other variables, so every quadratic word W defines a closed compact surface as the quotient space of a polygon whose sides are labeled with W. What does that mean? That basically means that instead of a polygon, we can consider a disk. So we can consider a disk on a plane, right? And then we can write W on the perimeter of our disk D. Okay, so for instance, if W is X inverse, let me draw it nicer. So let's say if I have an equation X inverse Y inverse Z inverse X Y Z times C inverse equals to one. Okay, so this is a product. This is a product of seven letters. So let me draw a polygon with seven vertices. Let me choose one vertex as the initial vertex, and then let me label the edges. So I'm going to label this edge as X. Yes, and I'm going to use this orientation. The next edge will be labeled with Y, and I'm going to use this orientation. Wait a second.
Yeah, we can see the word over the figure.
Okay. Let me move it like this.
A little closer.
Set up here. Okay, something like this, right? Okay, and then you label the edges. This edge will be labeled by C, and then you read X, you read Y, you read Z, and finally you read the C inverse. So let me label this H with C. So C is a constant which comes from capital G. Okay, so
yes. I think if you temporarily stop sharing, you may be able to see it. Zoom might actually.
Yeah. It's difficult to see this.
Stop. If you stop the share, it'll be easier to see.
Yeah, because right now, yes, yeah, that's better.
That's much better. Yes, thank you.
Okay, so consider a polygon with 7 vertices, and choose the initial vertex, and then you need to use proper orientation. You simply label the edges with x, y, z, x, y, z, and c inverse, right? So now if you start reading along the boundary of this disk, you will read exactly x inverse, y inverse, z inverse. Yes, so you will read exactly that that equation, right? Okay, so start with this disk, which corresponds to, to the given equation. And then identify edges labeled the same way. So for instance, here we have the edge labeled with X and another edge labeled with X. Identify those edges. So identify X with X, identify Y with Y, identify Z with Z. Yes, and you will obtain a surface. Actually, in this case, you are going to obtain a sphere with a single hole labeled by C. Okay, so that sphere is orientable. So that's why we say that equation is orientable. Okay, now let me turn this on. Okay, so indeed, we say that our equation is orientable if the corresponding surface is orientable, the surface obtained like that, yes, and non-orientable otherwise. Non-orientable otherwise. Yes, and it's well known that W is one. I mean, our quadratic equation is orientable if and only if every variable X, which occurs once as X, W is orientable if every X which occurs, I'm sorry. It's a mess. It's well known that a given quadratic equation W is one is orientable if and only if for every variable X which occurs in W, X occurs once as X and X occurs once as X inverse. Yes, and you can read some. You can find some definitions in Paul Shoup's paper. Yes, if quadratic equations in groups, cancellation diagrams on compact surfaces, and automorphisms of surface groups. So it's a pretty old paper. You can find some properties. He discusses some properties of. Of those surfaces and diagrams related to those surfaces. Okay, so next, let me define special forms of orientable and non-orientable equations called the standard quadratic equations. So in the first equation is of the following form. We have a product of G commutators. So here we have commutators of variables x, xi, and yi, right? And then we have some product of conjugates of constants, right? So cj is an element of our group, yes. And we conjugate cj, each cj with some zj, some unknown zj. This equation is called a standard quadratic equation. Now, if you replace commutators with squares, you will get a standard non-orientable quadratic equation. So here, xi's are variables, zj's are variables, and in the first case, xi's, yi's, and zj's are variables. Do you have questions? It's not very difficult to see that For every quadratic word W, there exists some automorphism phi such that if W is orientable, then phi of W is of the form 1. So given any orientable equation, you can always apply some automorphism and get an equation of this sort. Similarly, if W is non-orientable, then you can find an appropriate automorphism phi such that phi of W is of this form. Okay, so you can always reduce orientable non-orientable equations to standard orientable non-orientable equations, and furthermore, phi can be found efficiently. Yes, I think that was done first by Grigorchuk and maybe by Kurchanov. Yes, please correct me if I'm wrong. Okay, now a special type of orientable equations is spherical equations. So spherical equations is a spherical equation is an orientable equation in which you don't have commutators, right? So you only have products of conjugates of constants from the group G. Okay, so you can define certain classes of spherical equations. By definition, CM is a class of spherical equations in which you have exactly M conjugators, defined by M conjugators. And if you take the union of all such equations U, you get all spherical quadratic equations. Now, the choice of terminology here reflects the fact that the surface which corresponds to a quadratic word W of this form is a sphere with M disks removed. So if you construct the surface, you are going to get a sphere. And geometrically, the diophantine problem for a quadratic equation W equals to 1 can be viewed as a problem to find a tiling of a surface corresponding to W using the relations of the group G. So for a quadratic equation W equals to 1, you can construct the corresponding surface, yes, and your equation has a solution if and only if there is a tiling. So it's if and only if it's possible to tile the obtained diagram using the relation of the group G. Okay, and another remark, it's easy to see that the diophantine problem for C1 is the same as the word problem, right? Because if you have an equation Z inverse times C times Z equals to 1. Clearly, that's the diophantine problem for such an equation is equivalent simply to deciding if C is trivial or not. Yes, and similarly, the diophantine problem for C2 is defines the conjugacy problem. Okay, so we can say that the diophantine problem for spherical equations in G naturally generalizes the word problem and the conjugacy problem in G. Do you have any questions? Okay, so next, let me define the three partition problem. So the three partition problem, an instance of the three partition problem is a multiset of 3 times k integers. So for such a multiset, let's define the value L, which is defined like this. You take the sum of all the values of all the numbers, and then you divide by K. Now you say that your multiset is a positive instance of the three partition problem if it's possible to partition your set into K triples such that the sum for each triple is exactly LS. Okay, and the three partition problem is a problem to decide if a given multiset capital S well satisfies this condition. Now, this problem is strongly NP-complete, which means that this problem is NP-complete even when AIs are given in unary, so as sequences of ones. Yes, which is a very useful property. Now, a related problem is the partition problem. So that's a problem to decide if a given multiset S of positive integers can be partitioned into two subsets, S1 and S2, such that the sum of the numbers in S1 and in S2 are the same. Yes, and that problem is NP-complete if the numbers are given in binary and polynomial time decidable if the numbers are given in unary. Any questions? If there are no questions, then let me consider one case. One case for Baum-Slack solitary groups. So that's the unimodular case. So we consider the groups of the form BS and N. So we assume that these parameters are the same. And we claim that the Diophantine problem for these groups is NP-complete. Okay, so to actually prove that, we are going to reduce a three partition problem to the Diophantine problem, right? Okay, so let's consider an instance of the three partition problem. So let's consider numbers A1, A2, A3, K. And let's compute the anticipated subset sum. By the way, obviously, if that sum is not an integer, then clearly a given instance is a negative instance. So we may assume that this number capital L is an integer. Okay, and next we define certain group words. For an integer I, we define a group word BI, which is clearly a commutator of A inverse and t to the power minus AI. So define this word. Obviously, it's a commutator. And also, let me define the word B. You know what? I'm not going to read this word. It doesn't give us anything. Instead, we're going to consider the corresponding diagram. Okay, so anyway, define BIs, define B, and consider a spherical equation of this form. So this is a product of conjugates of the elements B sub AI. So these AIs come from our instance of the three partition problem. BAI is a commutator defined over here. Okay, so BAI here is a commutator of A and some power of T. Okay, and on the right-hand side, yes, we have B. So my claim is this equation has a solution if and only if S is a positive instance of the three-partition problem. Okay, so now let me visualize this word B. Okay, so this word B is, first we see some power of, of a certain word. So this word, that word starts with A, then we read T to the power L, then we read A inverse, and then we read T. So basically this word corresponds to, this part of my diagram, right? And then we take the case power of that word, which means that we repeat this part of the diagram K times, right? So this shape repeats several times. And in the end, we multiply by a certain power of T, which takes us back to the initial point. Okay, so basically what I'm trying to do, I'm trying to consider a cell on a sphere, which is labeled with that word B. Yes, and for convenience, I'm trying to give a certain shape to that cell. right? Because eventually, you know, I would like to show that I can tile a certain, I can find a tiling on a sphere using certain cells, right? Okay, but anyway, so that's how B looks like. Okay, so now, if S is a positive instance of the three partition problem, what does that mean? That means that we can partition our set of numbers into triples, right? Yes, such that, let's say, A1 plus A2 plus A3 is L. Okay, but if that's the case, then you see BIs are going to be, well, each BI is a commutator, so it's a small brick. And since AI, let's assume that A1 plus A2 plus A3 is capital L. So using these three bricks, we can actually nicely tile this area. Yes, we can nicely tile, and this point is going to be identified with the corresponding point on this long power of T. Okay, and then I can repeat that procedure. So if S is a positive instance of the three partition problem, then I can tile this cell using BIs. Okay, and that means that my equation has a solution. Do you have questions? Now, the converse is a bit more complex. So to prove the converse, we need to show that if the defined equation has a solution, then that solution defines somehow a solution for the three partition problem. And basically the proof goes like this. So if our equation has a solution, in that case, I can tile my sphere using this cell, using commutators given by BAIs, and plus I can use the relations that come from BS and N, right? Okay, so the first step in the proof is to show that you actually don't need to use the relations from BS and N, to tile your sphere, which means that if you have a solution, I mean the corresponding tiling on a sphere is going to look exactly like that. And once you have this type of configuration, obviously A1 plus A2 plus A3 is capital L, A4 plus A5 plus A6 is capital L, and so on. So in some sense, you have to show that your solution is in some sense rigid. There are not so many solutions, and solutions of these equations are of a very particular type. Do you have questions? By the way, it's also true that you can use this type of construction to prove that the Diophantine problem for spherical equations in free groups isn't p-complete. I mean, the construction works exactly the same way. Okay, so if you believe this statement, next, to show NP completeness, we need to show that the Diophantine problem actually belongs to NP, which again is not very difficult in this case for the group BS and N. Why? Because essentially in the Baumslag solitary group with parameters N and N, well, or N plus minus N, you don't have any distortion. You don't have any distortion, and basically you can show that the defined equation has a solution if and only if there is a tiling, there is a certain tiling of your surface. And if you have a tiling of your surface, then it's of bounded size. So the number of tiles that you will use for a solution will be bounded. Okay, and configuration of all those tiles is going to be, yes, is going to define, is going to be a certificate for, yes, for the fact that our equation is has a solution. Okay, now if we consider, now let's consider the case of where M and N are not the same. And by the way, we always assume that M and N are not trivial. So now I would like to show that the Diophantine problem for quadratic equations in BSMN is NP hard whenever M is not the same as N. Yes, and I'm not going to prove that in general, I'm just going to show you one case. I'm going to demonstrate that the problem is NP hard for BS12. Yes, because those particular values simplify a lot. Yes, and indeed, in general, if M is not the same as N, then there is a polynomial time reduction of the three partition problem to the Diophantine problem for the group BSMN. And actually, for the Diophantine problem for spherical equations. Anyway, indeed, to give a basic idea, let's consider BS12. So M is 1 and N is 2. Now, let me show you how the reduction works. For instance, let me consider a particular instance for the three partition problem. So let me consider a multiset with numbers 1, 1, 2, 3, 3, and 4. Now, the value of L here is going to be 7, and clearly this instance of the three partition problem is a positive instance. Why? Because for instance, 1 plus 3 plus 3 is 7, and the sum of the rest of the numbers, 1 plus 2 plus 4 is 7 as well. Okay, so this is a positive instance of this problem. Now, for these numbers, let me define numbers B1, B6. Okay, so numbers Bi will be defined in binary. So if Ai is 1, then Bi is simply 1 in binary. If Ai is 2, then let me write two copies of 1. So let me write 1, 1 in binary. Okay, so obviously that's 3. For 3, the value is going to be 7, and for 4, the value here will be 15. Okay, so you simply write a sequence of ones of this length in binary. And next, define the number B, which is defined like this. So you write 7 ones, so 7 is capital L, so write 7 ones, then write 0 as a separator, and then write another 7 copies of 1 in binary again. And now you can, and now it's easy to see by construction that the following are equivalent. A1, A6 defines a positive instance of the three partition problem if and only if this equation with exponents has a solution for X1, X6. Let's discuss that, why? I mean, it should be clear that if A1, A6 is a positive instance of the three partition problem, well, then indeed you can find you can partition your set of 3 times k numbers into triples, yes, such that the sum for each triple is L. Okay. So, but what does this basically equation does? I mean, what does it do to each BI? So by definition, each BI is a sequence of ones in binary. When you multiply such a sequence by a power of 2, so that simply, you know, shifts that sequence x1 units to the left or to the right, right? And I mean, the same holds for every term in that sum. And so clearly, if A1, A6 is a positive instance, then you can basically group all the, well, all these sequences of ones, you know, to cover all the ones in this sequence. So yeah, you can find the correspondence between these BIs, I mean, between these ones used in the definition of BIs and the ones used in the definition of B. Right, you can cover all the ones nicely. And these separators, zeros, are going to distinguish particular sums that give us L. Does it make sense? Okay, so every positive instance of the three partition problem defines a positive instance of this equation with exponents with base 2, and the converse also holds. I mean, you have to make some argument, but it's also true. So if this equation has a solution, then that solution defines a solution for the three partition problem. I mean, for a given instance of, yes, of that problem. Yes, and furthermore, the initial instance of the three partition problem is positive if and only if this spherical equation over the group BS12 has a solution. Again, because you see, these conjugates are conjugates of powers of A, and we do know how conjugation works in BS12. So if you conjugate a power of A by A, well, that doesn't do anything. And if you conjugate some power of A by T, well, that multiplies the number, I mean, the power by 2, right? Or divides that power by 2. Okay, so that immediately defines an equation of this form. So this equation with exponents has a solution if and only if this spherical equation has a solution. Do you have questions?
I have a question to the formulation on the top of the slide. So GP is a Diophantine problem for all equations or just for quadratic equations?
Quadratic. I'm sorry. Yes, it's confusing. So here I consider only quadratic equations. You're right.
Thank you.
Yes, and okay. So let me just say that the same can be done for any pair of distinct parameters M and N. I mean, you still have to do something. You still have to provide some argument. Well, because for instance, if M is 2 and N is 3, in that case, you know, you have to work with powers of 2 over 3. So there should, I mean, you have to prove certain things. And also these BIs obviously must be integers. So BIs now must be properly constructed. But a very similar construction can be used to show a general result that the Diophantine problem for quadratic equations, actually for spherical equations in BSMN is NP-hard. And this is an oversimplified example. BS12 is an oversimplified example. Okay, let me go next to the next slide. Okay, so here I simply claim the following. I mean, first I make some remarks. It's very easy to check that the commutator width of BS1n is 1, right? And hence, it doesn't make sense to, I mean, it's not very interesting to consider orientable equations of genus greater than zero, right? Because an orientable equation of genus greater than or equal to one has a solution if basically if and only if the product of all constants in our orientable equations belongs to the Dirac subgroup. Yes, and this condition can be checked very efficiently in linear time. Okay, so hence in general, orientable equations, at least for BS1n, are not very interesting because the Diophantine problem has very easy solution in that case. If you want to consider general non-orientable equations, then it's good to know that the subgroup generated by all squares has verbal weights too, which means that if an element is can be expressed as a product of squares in BS1N, then it can be expressed as a product of two squares, right? Okay, which means that a non-orientable equation of genus greater than or equal to 2 has a solution if and only if the product of constants belongs to, belongs to this subgroup. And again, it's very easy to check membership into that subgroup, into that verbal subgroup. Okay, so yes, basically quadratic equations over BS1N are all about spherical equations. Well, technically there is one non-trivial case, the case when you have one copy of X squared. So the case of non-orientable equations of genus one. Yes, and those equations are also computationally hard. Okay, so let me just state these two theorems. So you can prove that. Yes, we proved that with Richard. There is a polynomial time reduction from the Diophantine problem for quadratic equations in BS1N to equations with exponents. It's a very technical reduction, and I don't want to discuss the details here. Okay, so you reduce quadratic equations over BS1N to equations with exponents, and then you prove that the equations, I mean, the Diophantine problem for equations with exponents belongs to NP. Do you have questions? Okay, so that basically proves proves an upper bound for the Diophantine problem for the Mithabilian case.
Sasha, there is a case of non-orientable of genus one, so it's...
Say it again?
There is a case of non-orientable equations of genus one.
Yes, for non-orientable equation of genus one, the same result is true. Mm-hmm. So those equations are NP-hard.
Okay, it's a separate case, right?
Yes, it's a separate case, right. Yes, and it's not very painful, but it requires some work to actually show that the Diophantine problems there belongs to NP. Mm-hmm. Okay, so what else do I need to say? Well, let me just mention this case, the Baum-Slack solitary group with parameters 2 and 3. Technically, I mean, some might say that that's the real Baum-Slack solitary group, because the group BS2-3 appears as the first group in the original paper by Baum-Slack and by Solitaire. Okay, so this group, what can I say about that group? That group is very hard, basically because it's a mixture of two cases, like the case, the unimodular case, BSNN, and the case with distortion, Mithabilian case, BS1N, right? So you have, obviously, you have exponential distortion and you have free subgroups. Okay, so that that groups, I mean, such groups are difficult. Yes, nevertheless, let me at least claim here the following result. I claim that the Diophantine problem for spherical equations in BS2-3, so that problem is decidable. That theorem is not written, and we still works on upper bounds on different things. But basically, to prove such a claim, what we do, we consider different tilings. We consider different tilings, and we try to prove that if a spherical equation over BS2-3 has a solution, then it has, in some sense, a bounded solution. Yes, and for that, we try to introduce some type of cancellation theory for those diagrams. Yeah. Yes, and I think we do have a bound on the size. we still need to analyze that bound further, so it's still a work in progress. Questions?
Alexis and Olga's result is for solvable, right, groups?
Yes, for Metabilian groups.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yes, but their result is in a sense much wider, because they consider all systems of
equations. Just arbitrary equations. Right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
On the other hand, their result is just decidability, right?
Of course.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. Thank you very much, Sasha. Well, thanks, Sasha. Very interesting talk. Okay, so now if there are questions that have not been asked yet, so you're welcome to speak up.
Is something known about general class of equations in both substellated groups?
Could you repeat?
Is something known about general class of equations, about general equations in bump solitary groups?
Not necessarily quadratic.
Not necessarily quadratic, right.
In which
bump solitary groups?
In what?
In bump solitary groups.
In all of them?
Yeah.
No. We don't know if equations over BS2-3 are decidable or not.
So BS1-2, for example.
For BS1-2, yes, that was done by Harlampovich, Lopez, Mesnikov. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But BS2-3?
No.
Yeah,
okay. So we only claim the result decidability for spherical equations at this point.
Understand.
Mm-hmm. Yes, one good question would be, so how about risk products of finitely generated abelian groups and Z, at least in Olga's law? Yes, in the paper by Harlampovich, Lopez, and Myasnikov, they also consider the Metabilian group, which is the risk product of a finitely generated group, and I believe Z. It's not very difficult to see that very similar results can be obtained for, yes, in that case, for these products of finitely generated abelian and Z. And right now, my student works on that. So, yes, and actually, that group must be easier to analyze in general, because you don't have any type of distortion, right? So numbers don't grow a lot. So I believe in general for those risk products, it should be true that the Diophantine problem is NP complete. It's easy to prove NP hardness. The most difficult part is to show that your problem belongs to NP, and I think it's true for these products.
But you say now also for only for quadratic equations, right?
I said that it's easy to prove all results like what I discussed here. Yes, for these products. Yes, but I believe that in general the Diophantine problem belongs to NP for all equations.
What do you think about other Metabilian groups? Maybe like free Metabilian? I don't know if it's done or not.
But for free Metabilian groups, we published a paper with Igor recently.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Yes, on quadratic.
Yeah, I remember equations. Now.
Yes,
right.
And
they're also at B-complete, right?
It's a very difficult paper.
Yeah.
In my opinion.
Yeah, it was something with stylings on the plane, right?
So in the beginning, you had these results about NP hardness and being in NP, right? So what does it give you about NP completeness of something or other? So what's is there an NP completeness here in combination, so or not?
Right. So in these two cases, we have the NP completeness result. So in the metabilian case, so for BS1N, the diophantine problem for at least for quadratic equations is NP complete. Yes, and in the unimodular case, it's also NP complete for quadratic equations.
Okay. Okay, are there any other questions for Sasha?
I have a question about the descriptions. Since all the reductions are effective and we have the description of exponential equation solutions, we can also get descriptions of quadratic equation solutions in those groups, right?
So we proved with Richard that if a quadratic equation has a solution, then it has a bounded solution, and I believe those conjugates will be bounded. I mean, they depend like cubically. Yes, the bound is cubic in the size of the description of a given equation. Something like that. It's true.
Yeah. Oh, actually, I just remembered I had one more question about, I don't know, maybe you said it and I missed it during the talk. But when you convert the general quadratic equations to the specific form quadratic equation, you said that the conversion can be done efficiently, but it's also NP, right? Or no?
Sorry, are you talking about this?
Let me see. Yes,
it's very efficient. Can be done efficiently. I'm not sure that can be done in at most quadratic time, but maybe someone knows how to do it in linear time.
Oh, okay.
Yes, and actually this reduction has many nice properties. For instance, phi of W is not longer than the original W.
Okay.
Yes, so. Yes, and essentially phi somehow shuffles the letters inside of W nicely.
Sasha, hello. Hello first, maybe you said it or I forgot it. In the unimodular case, you said you can have NP completeness for quadratic equations, BSNN. And about general equations, what about? You can solve all of them?
I don't know. It's a good question. I don't know. So,
you said it's virtually
FM cross Z.
Yes. So in particular, it's virtually over right angle Artin group. Huh?
Oh, okay.
Yes, but I don't think that there's any results in this direction. Huh? Even for this case. I mean, for this case.
Sorry. Volker?
Yeah.
This is Laura. Now, about this case, we have a paper with Derek and Sarah that shows that virtually direct products of hyperbolic groups have decidable equations. So this
the
fits in
yes,
that.
Then.
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
So much more general direct products and virtual extensions.
But the general case, I think, is still open, or? Huh?
Yeah, virtual rugs, yes. Yeah.
Rachel. Okay. Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much for the nice talk, Sasha.
Okay, very good. All right, so let us thank Sasha again. Thank you. Okay, so I'll stop the recording now.